Negotiating a free trade agreement between two countries can be tough enough. But in the case of TTIP, one party represents 27 countries. To get a sense of the opportunities and challenges this creates, the GED team arranged for Bertelsmann Foundation's Tyson Barker and Andre Stucklick to sit down with EU Trade Commissioner Karel de Gucht.
So to begin with, what do you think will be the main benefits of the TTIP for the European economy and especially for the European citizens?
The idea is that we would team up the two biggest economies in the world, huh? The European Union being the biggest and the United States being the second biggest. It's also a mature economy, so they have the same level of development. It will certainly facilitate cooperation between European and American companies and make more likely that we invest more in the United States and the United States invests more with us. And that's going to create jobs, obviously.
What do you think that the effects of a comprehensive agreement would be on economic cohesion and convergence within Europe? And could disparities, economic disparities, increase or decrease?
The ability of member states to export is certainly enhanced by a number of measures that have been taken by the countries that got into difficulty, and especially in those member states. And you see that, by the way, at the export figures of countries like Spain, that now, for the first time since a very long time, by the way, have a trade surplus. And even when they were almost at the depth of the crisis, nevertheless, Italy was marking a trade surplus. So I believe that the kind of measures that have been very painful, but they have largely contributed to their competitivity. So they are now much better placed, I believe, to be very efficient in trade. So that will help them, and it will also contribute to the convergence between the member states. If they do better, the convergence will be bigger, I believe.
What do you think is the political integration impetus or the underlying political integration effect of TTIP in Europe?
TTIP, it's of course also happening in an economic environment, but it's also happening in a changing world. And you could ask yourself, why do the Americans agree to have this discussion now and did they not in the past? Because it's politically and geopolitically driven. Again, no, it's about repositioning our economies in the world economy. That's partly what it is about. Mm-hmm. And by the way, if it were not that, you would never get to an agreement, because we should not underestimate the difficulties we are going to face. We'll only be able to face them provided that everybody is aware of this very important political, geostrategical element in it that should help us to overcome a number of problems that we are certainly going to face.
In your eyes, do you perceive any global risks or challenges of such an initiative? Our research says that we may estimate or we may assume that to some extent Canada and Mexico, for instance, will be, at least for the time being, relatively losers of the strengthening of a bilateral trade agreement between the US and the European Union. So do you expect any sort of diverted trade effects on these neighbor countries?
The biggest trunk of it, it's about regulations. If you have to do that with four partners, I mean, then I believe it becomes almost impossible. But clearly, once we have an agreement, we will have to sit around the table with Canada and with Mexico, and we all have already told that very clearly. We will have to. It's important for everybody that we reach an early agreement. Now, we are not going to reach an early agreement if we are to multiply the partners. Then you can forget about it. But I realize that, yes, this will have an effect.
Adding to this, some critics would argue that TTIP will eventually lead to the death of the Doha Round.
I think it could very well function as a lever. One should look at what are the real reasons why we are stuck in the Doha Round. You know, the paradigm of the Doha Rounds was and is that there is an asymmetry in obligations between the least developed countries, the emerging economies, the developed countries and the developing countries. No? If we are successful in making this agreement, that's an if, and it's not a small if, but if we are successful, that I think will certainly influence that kind of debate in the Doha round. And if that debate, if at least that debate starts again, you know, on what is the real problem within Doha, that's the real starting point, I believe, to come to a conclusion of Doha. So it could very well be used as a lever.
What do you think will be the biggest hurdles and the most sensitive issues in negotiations?
You know, in such a negotiation, you never know on beforehand, because it depends on a lot of things, you know. All of a sudden, what you would think is a rather small problem, all of a sudden is mushrooming and overshadowing everything. So it's difficult to say. But what technically certainly is the most challenging, it's regulation. Regulation where you will have making them compatible, making them equivalent, sometimes harmonizing them. And for the future, we should find a way avoiding that we have divergent regulation. So this is certainly technically very, very difficult, and also politically, because the way that we set standards, norms, and establish regulations, and the United States do that, are not the same.
So do you think that a two-year timeline is realistic for the talks, for negotiation?
That's very difficult to predict, but we are starting those negotiations with that ambition, because if you really are convinced that it could be a major contribution to getting us out of the crisis, okay, then you shouldn't work at it 5 years, huh? No? Then you better do it as quickly as possible, huh?
Commissioner de Gucht, thank you so much for your time.
Thank you.